This question is an easy to medium difficulty GMAT data sufficiency question. Comes from the topic number properties. If you have to classify, I'll classify this question as a 600 to 650 level question. The question is this, why an integer? Before we look into the two statements, let's get clarity on these two questions. One, what kind of an answer will this question fetch? And when is the data sufficient? This question is an is question. Anything that starts with is, with was, does, are, all of these be verb starting questions, the answer is going to be yes or no. When is the data sufficient? The data is sufficient if you're able to come up with a definite yes. We're saying that yes, y is an integer and it can't be anything else. The data is sufficient. Conversely, if you're able to answer the question with a conclusive no, if you're saying that no, y can never be an integer, even then the data is sufficient. Note, answering with a definite no also means that the data is sufficient. When is it not sufficient? You're saying that it may be an integer, may not be an integer. I'll just give you a sample statement. If the statement were to be something like y is greater than 0, and the question asked is y an integer? Y greater than 0, y could be a 1.5, y could be a 2. If it's a 1.5, the answer is no. If it's a 2, the answer is yes. Both these values satisfy the condition that y is greater than 0. This kind of a scenario, we'll say we are not sure whether y is an integer. Such a statement, data is not sufficient, right? So you got clarity on when the data is not sufficient. Let's look into the statements. Let's start with statement one alone. The approach I'm going to take for this statement, which is y cube is an integer, is what we'll call as a counterexample. Counterexample, we'll look for one example where y cube is an integer. You can never make this incorrect. Y cube should always be an integer. We'll look for one value where y is an integer, and we'll see if we can find one value where y is not an integer. Start with y cube being an integer. Y cube equals, let's say, an 8. So what will be the value of y? Y is equal to 2. Is y an integer? The answer is yes. So we've got one example where y cube is an integer and y is also an integer. Let's look at a counterexample. Let's see if we can find one. Let's say y cube equals a 2. I'm just picking this 2 right straight away from here. So what will be the value of y? Y is equal to cube root of 2. Cube root of 2 is certainly not an integer. So is y cube an integer here? Yes, that information is true. We have not made that incorrect. Is y an integer? Y is not an integer. So if y cube is an integer, will y be an integer? It could be, it need not be. We have not been able to come up with a conclusive answer. We are not sure. It in some cases is an integer and in others it is not. So statement one is not answering our question. So statement one is not sufficient. So what all answer options can we rule out? When one is not sufficient, we can rule out answer options A and D. A says statement 1 alone is sufficient. We realized 1 is not sufficient. D says each statement is independently sufficient. If 1 alone is not sufficient, how can these statements be independently sufficient? So we ruled out 2 options. We have eliminated 40% of the answer options. We are down to remaining 3, B, C or E. So you have a 1/3 possibility of getting this question right. We have improved the chances from 1 in 5 to 1 in 3. We'll summarize this, have a takeaway before we move on to statement 2. Basically, we said we're going to evaluate the statement using counterexample. We took y cube to be an 8. We took y cube to be a 2. In y cube is an 8, the answer is yes. When y cube is a 2, the answer is no. In both these cases, y cube is an integer. So statement 1 is not giving us a definite answer. 1 alone is not sufficient. If 1 alone is not sufficient, we can eliminate answer options A, D. We are down to B, C or E. The key takeaway is this. More often than not, when you're solving such questions, the temptation is you'll substitute values for y and not for y cube. That's when you tend to go wrong. Always follow what the statement is asking you to do. The statement asked us to make y cube an integer. It said that make y cube an integer and from there evaluate what y is. Look at it. How often, if I asked you, give me a number less than 10. Usually you'll say a 7 or a 3 or depending upon whether it's a lucky number for you or an unlucky number for you, right? How often would you have said, give me a number less than 10? Would you have given me a number which is -8.43? Is -8.43 less than 10? Certainly yes. So when you're substituting values for y, you're likely to pick an integer as a value for y. The question is y an integer? If you've chosen an answer where the number for y is already an integer, you're not going to get anything that is counter to this. So never do what the statement is not asking you to do. The statement is asking you to make y cube an integer. So always when you're doing counterexamples, plug in values for y cube and from there deduce what y could be. Never substitute values for y. This is a common trap that we get into. Avoid this trap. So more to statement 2. Statement 2 says 3y is an integer. I'm going to take the same approach, counterexample. I'm going to take 3y to be equal to a 6. If 3y is a 6, y is equal to 2. Is y an integer? The answer is yes. going to take another example where 3y will continue to be an integer. Let's go with 3y equals 7 itself. What's the value of y? Y is equal to 7 by 3. Is y an integer? No. So 3y being an integer, should y be an integer? It need not be. There are examples where it is. There are examples where y is not an integer. So from statement 2, we still don't have a conclusive answer. We're not able to say whether y is an integer. At the end of evaluating statement 1, we eliminated answer options E, D. We were down to B and C or E. We had three options. We looked at statement 2. 2 is also not sufficient. So let's eliminate answer option B. Answer option B states that 2 alone is sufficient. We realize 2 alone is not sufficient. Summarize it. Have a quick takeaway before we combine the two statements. Right? We're going with counterexample. Taking 3y to be a 3. We're taking 3y to be a 4. In both instances, 3y is an integer. One case, y is an integer. In another case, y is not an integer. Statement 2 alone is not sufficient to answer the question. Eliminate answer option B. We are down to C or E. Again, the takeaway is exactly the same. Do what the statement asked us to do. I picked values for 3y. That's what you should be doing. Do not pick values for y. Let's evaluate the statements together because each statement independently was not sufficient. When we evaluate the statements together, we'll be able to decide whether the answer is C or it is E. We evaluate the statements together. This is what we have. Y cube is an integer and 3y is an integer. Let me start with 3y because I'll explain why we are starting with 3y. I'm going to take three consecutive values for 3y and make those such values, all of which are integers. 3y equals a 6, 3y equals a 7, 3y equals an 8. Right? We'll check out what happens when we go beyond this. Let's start here. So what's the value of y? Y equals 2. Is 3y an integer? Yes, yes, yes. I said I'm going to take values such that 3y is an integer. What's the value of y? Y is equal to 7 by 3. What is the value of y? Y is equal to 8 by 3. Now, what is the value of y cube? Y cube is 8. Is it an integer? Yes. So, when 3y equals 6, y ended up being a 2 and y cube was an integer. The two statements are holding good for this value. Is y cube an integer? Certainly not. It's 343 divided by 27, not an integer. So if 3y is an integer, that's holding good. In this case, y cube is not an integer for such values. Let's look at this. Here again, y cube is going to be equal to 512 by 27, which is also not an integer. So if 3y is an integer and y cube is an integer, I'm going to infer the following. Look at it. If y is not an integer, y cube cannot be an integer. So if the statement said 3y is an integer and y cube is also an integer, that is going to be possible only when y is an integer. So comparing the two statements, we know 3y is an integer. We know y cube is an integer. Therefore, we can conclude that y has to be an integer. Why did I only take three values? When I go to 3y equals 9, I'm again going back to the same thing. Y equals 3, then it'll be a 10 by 3, then it's going to be 11 by 3, so on and so forth. So if I pick three consecutive values for 3y, all three of which are integers, realize that in two instances, y will not be an integer and therefore y cube cannot be an integer. The only instance where y cube will be an integer is where y is also an integer. So if both these will have to hold good, that is possible only when y is an integer. So if these two statements are taken together, we can answer the question with a definite yes. Choice C is the correct answer to the question. Before you leave, I'd like you to sign up as a trial user at wzko.in/core. Get started with your GMAT quant preparation. Start with a free topic, statistics and average. It'll take you about 3-4 days, sometimes even 5-6 days to nail that topic. Build momentum to your quant preparation and then switch to a paid user and get access to the remaining 19 topics. Lastly, before you leave, subscribe to the channel. And some of you might be interested in becoming a member of the channel. Click on the join button for a small monthly fee. You'll get some member-only perks which are available over and above whatever is available to all subscribers. Best wishes for your GMAT preparation.